Welcome back, League of Legends fans, to MSI 2021 here in the Rumble stage. Two games left to play here today, the first of which pits Pentanet.gg versus Damwon Kia. Now, Damwon currently tied for second in the six teams remaining in the competition here. Pentanet, one of the only two teams still without a win.
But looking to pick up a big upset win here. But I've loved the attitude of the Pentanet guys. You know, it feels like they're not taking themselves too serious. They're joking around. You know, the coach was giving an interview earlier today. He's like, yeah, we got RNG and Damwon, so it should be two easy wins here today. You know, like, we see them in the tease for the MSI Rumble stage. Pavu just dropping the, we're just here to have fun, right? You know, these guys have come in with a lot of smiles on their faces, with some cool drafts, with some good play. And they're going to be looking to kind of throw out, I would think, some pretty exciting picks and try to surprise Damwon. I think that's their best chance at the win.
I mean, we saw them try that against RNG, right? Mm-hmm. We saw them try to just change the game up. You're not going to beat them in a head-to-head, just straight-up standard vanilla game of League of Legends, so we want to see creativity from Pentanet. They'll start off with a Lee Sin first pick here in the draft, as Lucian, Renekton, Sylas, Morgana, Varus, and Thresh are all banned away.
Yep, and while I did mention last game, Lee Sin is normally top, that has not been true for Pentanet. It has actually been four games mid lane for Chaz. Biopanther yet to play the pick. That could change here, but for now I'm going to default to assuming that this is going to be mid lane here for Chaz. At the same time, Canyon going to be able to grab the Udyr, which does leave Rumble available, but again, back to that kind of little triangle that I was talking about, I do feel like it's shaking out to Udyr greater than Rumble, Rumble greater than Morgana, so we do see them getting the advantage as far as that does go for Canyon. And Canyon has been a monster. People have been critical of his Rumble play, though, especially the positioning of his ultimates. The heat management is something that a lot of junglers have been getting flack for, Canyon included, despite the fact that he's been known as one of the best, if not the best, mechanical jungler in the world. And he'll have his opportunity to run the show against Pabu here in this game.
Yep.
Jace is the answer for Khan into the Gnar top. So again, it should be Lee Sin mid. That is going to be in the favor of Khan. This is an advantageous matchup. You also have the jungle 1v1 advantage. You should have a 2v2 advantage. So this is going to be a tough one for Biopanther. But I will say, I think Biopanther has been the standout for me from this PGG team. It always feels like when they're falling behind, you're looking at, you know, a lot of deaths across the board. You look up to the top side, and Biopanther's having a pretty good game, generally speaking. So we'll see if he can hang on here, withstand the onslaught against this Jace, against Canyon, if he wants to get up there and try to really pressure this Gnar.
Okay, so let's see what the bans will look like here in the second half. We already got two of them. It's Senna and Leona banned away, as Samira is taken off the table here as well. Samira, one of those AD carries you don't see as much in competitive play, but she's also very different compared to most AD carries. She likes to dive in. She can do that. I'm Katarina and Yasuo and everything else all put together, spin around with the resets, blocking all the projectiles. So take that sort of wild card out of the options of what you have to play against. Try to make them play something a bit more standard. Nocturne being banned out by Pentanet here, and it's back to Damwon for their fourth pick.
Exactly, and Praedith played Samira twice already in this tournament, and if you're looking at it from the side of Damwon, that is one of the best snowballing marksmen in the game, if not the best. You know, we've all had those games where Samira gets an early double kill, all of a sudden she's on shield bow, she's not losing health while you're focusing her, she's pentakilling your whole team with the ultimate.
Keyboard breakers. Yeah, I've had some of those.
Yeah, so those are the kind of games that Damwon looking to avoid here. Xayah gonna be the choice over on the side of PGG. They could pair that with the Rakan if they do so choose. They will be going into the Nautilus plus Kai'Sa as the bottom lane over on their side. We're expecting fifth pick to probably be AP here for Showmaker. He's got a lot of options over there. That will be Alistar looking like the choice here. So definitely a lot of engage there on the Alistar, and he's going to be most of their primary engage. Of course, there is the possibility of a flank from the Gnar, from the Lee Sin, but generally speaking, a lot of pressure here on Decoy to be able to start those fights, to be able to find the combo. And there is a good CC chain for kill threat that you can actually pull off here with the Alistar plus the Xayah. You combo in, the Xayah throws the feathers through, roots out of the stun, then you have the Alistar trample stacked up, so you can stun there right after that. So that's what they're looking for over on the Kai'Sa. Showmaker gonna go for Zoe here. fits really well with her composition. Traditionally, you do see Zoe with at least one additional poke style of champion. That's how most people like to draft her. In this case, they have the Jace, early pressure up on the top side, winning matchup there. You then group up with the Zoe. You look to poke down and weaken up some of the PGG champions. And then you utilize the Nautilus, the Udyr, to start up these fights. The Kai'Sa can fly in to follow that up, and you look to wipe them off the map here. So will be pretty exciting. I do think that Lee Sin should have pressure in mid lane as long as they're playing it, you know, at an even level, but that's not a given. Showmaker is an incredible mid laner. That being said, if you go resolve secondary, if you start D-Shield, you E-Max, or even in some of these really tough mid lane matchups, you can put a couple more points in W to just survive the poke.
Yeah.
You can shrug off almost all poke from some of these mid laners in the early game and just relentlessly shove, group up with your jungler, try to get things done on the map. And to me, that's Pentanet's chance. You know, when we saw them play Lee Sin earlier and Lee Sin was locked in lane, stuck under his tower against RNG, that to me was actually kind of what ended that game, because Lee Sin needs to be moving around the map, needs to be proactive, getting things done. And I think especially against a team like Damwon, you can't be comfortable when you're at parity. You've got to create and snowball a lead.
So that's what we're sort of looking at here compared to last game. Because the question that I wanted to pose you is, we literally started this off by saying Pentanet is looking for an upset here in this matchup.
Yeah.
I think most people that are approaching this game from looking at the numbers, looking at the stats, would expect Damwon to be able to win. So I've been told that we have a pause as the game is starting, so I'm just going to ask this question that could have a potentially longer answer since we have the time to ask it. Along with Lee Sin in particular being able to not be stuck under the turret and sort of unlocking him to roam around and be that playmaker, what does this early game need to look like for Pentanet specifically for you to believe they have an honest chance against Damwon?
I mean, it's tough, right?
Yeah.
If you're closing your eyes and turning off the nameplates, the answer is very different than if you're answering for Pentanet versus Damwon.
We have nameplates enabled in this question.
Nameplates enabled. I'm not going to start believing unless they're like 5K up in the early game, right?
Like,
Damwon has not had a good early game and has been able to pull off so many wins despite having poor early games against stronger teams than Pentanet. And that is my honest answer, is that I think it needs to be a monumental lead for Pentanet to really have a good shot at closing it out. I think that when you look over at the other side, Damwon is going to be tough to deal with in the later stages of the game. A lot of poke. There's only really the Alistar for engage. So if the Alistar engage, you know, gets kited back or stifled in some way, it's going to be really tough to actually close the gap to the Zoe and the Jace. And very likely Pentanet gets poked out and then taken down. So I do think they need an enormous lead given the compositions, but also given the players here, because Damwon is so adept at playing out the mid and late game team fights,
yeah,
even from a deficit against the best teams in the world.
Yeah, Pentanet definitely has their work cut out for them here. But honestly, once we get past the pause, I am looking forward to seeing what sort of creativity they bring to this game, because I don't expect them to just walk quietly to their lanes and say, all right, guys, let's have a normal laning phase, shake hands and everything. I want to see Pentanet really try something wacky again. I want to see this team experiment. When the deck feels this stacked against you, when you're up against the team that everybody had as number one or number two coming into this tournament, you've got to be able to try something new.
Yeah, absolutely. And so Pabu is reporting that his runes did not save. League officials are investigating. We will give you an update as we receive more info ourselves. But that is what we are waiting on. So I assume Pabu has the wrong runes, unfortunately for him. But hopefully that'll get all fixed up. Anyway, you can look towards some of the crazy stuff. I'm not expecting a lane swap because Sion's not in the game, right? Sion, I think, was the key part of what enabled them to go for that earlier today against RNG. You know, you have the Sion execute on bot side, take a buff, so you three buff to start it off. You go down, you get Dove, who cares? You're Sion, you clean it up with a zombie, you TP back to lane. You know, that you can really pull off. If you try to pull off like a lane swap here with a Gnar, who's going to be down on the bottom side, zoned off all XP in the Dove level one, it's probably not going to look that good.
No, probably not.
So I don't think we can get those kind of shenanigans. So then it becomes about, you know, where is the playmaking? It's not from Rumble early game, right? It's not really from Gnar in a losing matchup early game. It's not from the Zaya. So to me, that's why I focus on the mid lane, because that's the only kind of point of inflection that I really do see. You know, Alistar, I don't think, you know, when you're talking about especially the level one, level two, is going to be able to get that much done against the Nautilus and the Kai'Sa. So I think so much comes down to, can Chaz lane well enough against Schoemaker here to get the push, to create opportunities to swing the jungle matchup, right? You know, you're thinking Udyr has an advantageous matchup 1v1 against the Rumble. You're thinking Jace has the advantage against the Gnar. So that is where it's really tough, and we're in the game, so.
Okay, I have an update. League officials determined that Pabu did not save his runes. It was user error, not an error in the client or in anything else. They have determined that it was Pabu's bad. It was his fail. So the game is going through without the rune changes. Now, fortunately for Pabu, it doesn't seem completely disastrous. It's not like he took Grasp of the Undying or something. Conqueror's, I mean, I think it's still pretty bad compared to Dark Harvest, but it's not the worst possible thing.
Yeah. Yeah, sorry, I was just cracking up to that barrel hook. not what you expect to see. I was like, "Well, they're gonna get decoy splash here. That sucks." Just face blunt straight into a
Sometimes
wall.
Sometimes it happens, man. You can't always be.
Who put that wall here? Who did that? Let's get a pause. The wall move for sure.
Unlucky. Just a little bit of unlucky here early on. It's before the minion spawn. He's getting the bad shots out of his system now. But let's see if Damwon decides to go for anything super cheeky here. The ward will be left by Pentanet at their own.
They're going to start blue.
Okay, they can see Khan. They can see Canyon. They know what's going on.
Yeah, now the question is, do you agree to split map or do you try to contest in some way? Because you have the losing jungle map up here, matchup for Pabu, I don't think you actually get an option. So I think it's like, sorry, bud, you know, you now have to play bot side and good luck, Biopanther. You know, you're now going to be stuck on this island in a losing matchup, losing jungle matchup. You can see that Canyon's going over to the Gromp as well. He may actually want to do a full three camp clear on that side. He also has the option at trying to come in and contest at his own blue quadrant, but he will just do full three camp clear. So it's going to be that swap of sides on the map. Rumble will play towards bot side. But look at this. Actually, Damwon's all going back to protect the blue. This is disaster. Now it's going to be a full three quadrants because the bot lane had push, Zoe had push. Everyone from Damwon comes back, stops Pabu from being able to even trade sides. So it's actually not a map split. It's just a we get the whole map and you get nothing split, which I don't even know what that is.
That's a trade offer like a Cloud9 Scuttle Crab. We don't like those trade offers
in
ever.
The history of trade deals. Maybe ever, Flowers.
That is not good stuff when the best thing you can say about your level 2 as a jungler is at least I didn't give any gold when I died. It's not a good day. So Pabu's going to have to go back to farming now. He lost his red buff. He's dead to the turret. And we'll just see Canyon get to have the time of his life in the jungle. 5-19
but
in the farm, Mr. Azale.
Bright side, when he kills the Krugs here, he's going to double his CS.
Okay, that's the, I would call that silver lining, but it feels more like glitter on a really, really dark cloud, as you can see.
It's kind of more like a gum lining, like, you know, when it gets stuck to your shoe.
Like on the bottom of a chair at a public school cafeteria. Oh, it's nasty.
That's where we're at, you know?
Oh.
You got to deal with the harsh realities here, Flowers.
Oh, no, man.
The best you can hope for. It could be something worse, you know? I'm not going to go there, but it could be even worse.
Okay, well, right now, at least there's only one of these little scuttle crabs taken. Maybe Pabu can make his way into the topside river. He's got Chaz next to him with that mid lane priority, so Pabu at least won't get double crabbed. And considering his start, that is something that could have very easily happened. So we call this a dub here for Pentanet, grabbing that crab there in the top side. Khan's just playing back here, allowing Biopanther to shove out the lane. And we'll just see Khan be able to farm it up nice and easy. No problem with it. Pabu in the enemy jungle, stealing away the Krugs, just trying to catch up a little bit here in this jungle.
They do know he's here, though. And Canyon's running straight up. And Jace can collapse. So you might be dead, or they might get the Flash Force. Khan can come down. Canyon can wait on the other side. As long as Khan wins the 1v1, you don't actually need to go over the wall here as Canyon. So Flash Force, now Canyon can come.
Yep, Pabu already flashing, walking back towards his own top laner. Canyon's here with a follow-up. Biopanther trying to run away. First blood over to Canyon, and they're about to make it 2. Bear slap into bringing down the hammer, and Khan picks it up.
Oh, you really hate to see it happen. Pentanet down about 2K gold here, 4 minutes in. This is looking like a toughie here for the OCE boys.
This is not the ideal state of the early game. Pentanet down 6.8 to 8.5K here in the gold. Showmaker has control over the mid lane. Khan has control over the top. And here is how the 2v2 went down. Khan just not afraid to throw it down here at the very start.
Yeah, I mean, this is just really smart, right? If Canyon flashes over the wall, Pabu flashes out, it's not really a big deal. Showmaker actually had cryo. You know, I talked about the importance of Lee Sin being able to move to try to make this composition work. Lee Sin could not move. He was under his tower. It's Showmaker that makes the first move. Khan forces out the flash. Canyon is there to follow it up. And Showmaker is there to secure that second kill. Dom1 playing this early game out so smart. You know, and one of the things that's always so interesting is a lot of times in these kind of map trade situations where one team's like, all right, I take top, you take bot, you both kind of high five and you just agree to it. You don't always have to agree to it, and Dom1 definitely didn't this game.
Well, we got Decoy getting away here with a headbutt as an escape mechanism back on towards Canyon. So Dom1 try to make a move here on the bottom lane, but they will not find any kills from it here so far. Back up in topside, it's Khan continuing to just dominate the lane here. Canyon, after having the success in his first bit of jungling, was able to go back by the completed Ionian Boots of Lucidity. During the great run at them fast jungle meta of 2021 spring, we got to see these items be incredibly important for these champions where movement speed means so much, like Udyr. And so Canyon will be all over the map, picking up the first Drake here, 6.5 minutes in for Dom1.
Yep, I think it makes a lot of sense here as the early purchase, not feeling overly pressured to go for the tabbies or anything like that. So just grabbing Lucidity, grab that early bit of move speed, and you can see he's about 800 gold ahead here. Chaz getting pushed in. They're looking for a re-engage bot side.
Okay, the 2v2 is going all the way. Decoy taking a lot of damage here with a very front line, having a flash away. Stays alive. Ignite won't kill him. Outplay maybe from Praetith, but no. They're stacking up the plasma. They're going to be taking him down too. Dredgeline comes out. Praetith goes down.
Praetith trying to go for the big play there. They needed something special. They know. They need some winning lane to swing this back because top lane is doomed. Jungle is doomed. Mid lane has been under his tower the whole game, so Praetith going for what I'm sure he knows is a risky play. It's a flash blade caller for the redirect over onto Barrel, but he can't get it. He just goes down as well. So it's now three heavily winning lanes plus jungle advantage all on the side of Dom1. And this one, I think, is about to start snowballing out of control.
Yeah, 3,000, 7.5 minutes in. Look at the plates just being slammed here in top lane as Biopanther arrives back to lane now. Still about 25 CS behind his opponent. Khan's just going to continue keeping the tempo high, keeping the wave shoved in, making sure that Dom1 has control over this top side of the map, because look at Canyon. He's in the enemy jungle doing whatever the hell he wants. Yes, it's the Pentanet jungle, but when Dom1 has control over both of the lanes around it, all of a sudden, Pabu's the one who's afraid to walk into the fog of war.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Chaz has farmed well, you know. So as far as the farm goes, as far as the gold goes, he's almost even, I believe. He's very close there. But the bigger deal is the fact that he can't get any pressure. He can't move around the map. Showmaker is always the one to push, then roam. That is the reason that Chaz is actually up in farm here. And that is really problematic because it's the same thing that happened to him on the Lee Sin against RNG. And when you cannot be proactive on the Lee Sin, this pick just does not have as much value straight up as a lot of the other meta picks, such as the Zoe. I mean, you know, it's even Zoe with Spellbook, utilizing that to get more utility towards later stages. Pentanet looking for a pick. This is one of their hopes in the game. Try to set up traps like this, and we'll see if they can pick off Khan.
Okay, Khan trying to disengage on this one. Meanwhile, back in the bottom lane, it's Praetith dropping again. Ghost getting the kill on him. Meanwhile, the camera pans back to top. Khan's still alive, didn't even use the flash.
Yeah, he's got phase rush and there was no CC. You don't have level 6 on the Rumble, so I think he actually just got that after the gank. They didn't have the Equalizer, they don't have Meganar, so really he just has to proc the phase rush and walk away. That's why the Observers, rightly so, pan down to that bottom side.
Thank
where
you,
Praetith is going down again. It's now 2 kills, 20 CS, 2 plates, all in that top side. And Biopanther, you got a Herald behind you, bud.
Oh,
and Pabu is here. They have Mega and they have Equalizer, so you gotta pray.
Yeah, they're just deciding to go for the 2v2. Ain't no turret to protect him any longer. Showmaker has decided it's his turn to join the fight now as well, with Khan going in for the damage. Biopanther falling over, and Showmaker grabbing a kill here for himself. Kanan continues the chase, but Pabu will be fast enough to escape. And here's Chaz, but he's not to the play in time. This is what you were talking about, Azale. When Lee Sin isn't unlocked to roam, when Lee Sin can't leave that mid lane comfortably, he shows up just to go ahead and attend the funeral of his teammates.
Yeah, it's just so tough, right? You know, in other matchups, it wouldn't be so important that the Lee Sin can get on the map. But when you have losing 1v1 in top lane, when you have losing 1v1 in jungle, the 2v2 isn't any better, the bot lane is falling apart. There's just so much pressure on a Lee Sin to be able to get out there, to be that playmaker, to be that difference maker, and he hasn't been able to do it just yet. And that was a really quick flash from Khan, deserving some credit there, to be able to react to Biopanther. If you land the Mega Gnar and the Equalizer does get laired, maybe you can at least salvage something from it, but instead, yep. 10 and a half minutes in, we are at 5.5k gold lead, all the objectives going in the favor of Dom1 as well. They're going to be setting up for this Cloud Dragon here and looking to speedrun this game.
Yeah, and remember back in the LCO, man, Pentanet wasn't exactly a team that had a high forward percentage. They weren't building those leads passively by having greater farm, by securing more objectives. A lot of their early strength came from kills and assists, right? They would pick the right fights. They would get ahead through that. But in an 0-5 game, nothing to be found, man. Pentanet just feels like the early game has completely collapsed with this 6,000 gold deficit. Dom1 are exactly where they want to be. This game is theirs for the taking.
Yeah, I mean, Dom1 just entered this game so intelligently. And I think they got advantages in the draft, but also they're level one. The three-man invade topside, knowing you have the advantage and knowing you can actually peel back. And
oh, and here we go again. Kanan has arrived. Decoy and Praedith getting themselves away. Pabu's here too, so Praedith will not die again. Does still have the Xayah ulti as well, so Dom1 doesn't want to go completely ham on a dive. Meanwhile, back in the top lane, it's Khan just continuing to absolutely slam in this 1v1 with the Eclipse completed. Remember, all he has to do is hit you twice, and he immediately gets that bonus max health damage. He gets that shield, which is so effective at preventing those little bits of turret damage. That one turret shot that you would get for that, completely nullified by the shield.
Yeah, I mean, you see Gnar get chunked to, what, 40, 50%, something like that? And Khan didn't even hit the power shot blast. If he hit that, he could have potentially just chased him down with the phase rush for a kill. So Biopanther is getting completely shoved back, but Dom1 just looking to continue invading.
Okay, Beryl and Kanan going for the invade here on the enemy red buff. Showmaker coming through with a paddle star. Gnar's goodbye, behind. Half of Pabu's health. Let's see if they can finish anybody off here. Doesn't look like it. Pentanet decide to back away from this one. Tragically, though, that was Biopanther's teleport used for no sort of a punish. So another big resource spent now for Pentanet.
Yep, and meanwhile, Khan taking everything from the topside jungle. So Pabu losing his camps up there. Chaz going to have to retreat. You can see the tower being taken in bot lane as well here by Ghost. This is really, really tough. I mean, Dom1 have played this out incredibly well. I do think that the level one was played so intelligently, not only, you know, the invade, knowing you had the early power, but the defense, you know, winning out in the 1v1 and the 2v2 mid and bot, defending without even your jungler being there, just retreating back into your jungle, pushing Pabu out, forcing that XQ. Really from the word go, is as soon as that happened, Pabu's kind of just screwed in this game, right?
Yep.
You know, your one hope, if that happens to you as a jungler, is that you can get some random kill on the map instantly to get back in the game, right? And maybe you can hope for that in solo queue, but
not here, dude. But not against Dom1.
Exactly. Like, they know exactly where you are because they've taken all your camps. They know you have to try something, so they ward it out. And when that's prevented, it's just like, what do you do? You're going to be so far down.
Here comes Udyr, and he is ready to fight. Chaz tries to get away. Dashes away with a safeguard to the warden because Pabu's there. They decide that they don't want to chase this any further. And we'll see if Dom1 goes for anything back in mid. Doesn't look like it. And Azale, I'm going to ask a question here because this is almost a 9,000 gold lead, 14 minutes into the game.
I liked your haircut better before.
No. Well, that just means you don't like my haircut. I'm going to pretend.
No, your haircut now is great. But your haircut before was majestic, and I know that's what you're going to ask.
Okay. Well, I appreciate what I think.
You were the Fabio of League of Legends.
Maybe that was a backhanded comment. I don't know. It was some kind of comment. I'm going to have to think about that later. Anyway.
You can pull it off.
Okay. Okay, I appreciate that. Yeah. I will take that one as a compliment. But the question I'm going to ask you now, Mr. Azale, with us being 100 gold away from a 10K lead at 14 and a half minutes, do you think this game will last longer than 21 minutes on the dot? I will give you the opportunity to take Baron and have it for 60 seconds.
I say yes. I say it'll last longer. Yeah.
Longer than 21 minutes.
Yeah, okay. I would say over that. I would guess under 25 is my guess. I mean, Dom won, I think, you know, if they get like, if PGG opt into a random fight and they get aced and they can just happen to end the game before that, they will. But my guess is that knowing Dom won, they'll just create a massive lead, force it Baron early, you know, get the ace around there and then look to actually push and end the game with the Baron buff. Of course, I could be wrong, but that's kind of my assumption here just based on what they've shown.
Oh no, Pabu, there's an Udyr in your jungle and he's not leaving anytime soon. Barrel's right next to him. Nautilus and Udyr roaming around together. That is such a scary combination. It would be so difficult to be able to not only outrun Udyr, but then dodge all the CC coming out from Nautilus as well. Canyon taking the opportunity to go for a Rift Herald here. 15 and a half minutes into the game, picking up the second one here for the squad. And they'll be able to use that to take whichever turrets they feel like. They've already got four under their belt. Both the Tier 1 and Tier 2 in that top lane have fallen. Remember, and now it's time to apply the pressure elsewhere. Biopanther mid-hop getting knocked away with a hammer. Flashes out, but the flash follow from Khan means a solo kill for the top lane of Dom1.
Yeah, and Barrel threatening to wrap around here. We'll back it up a little bit. Canyon does grab the Herald, but he just goes back to farm his side of the map with it. They get the solo kill. It will mean that bottom lane tower. The tier 2 mid pretty much gone at this point. So going to be tough for PGG to hang on. And we'll see how long they can. I mean, if they get another kill here and Canyon drops Herald, I mean, they could just honestly maybe end the game right with that. But it just feels like Dom1 don't want to take any risks. As much as they are so far ahead and this game is pretty well decided, it's really important for Dom1 to pick up the wins here too. Right?
Oh boy. You know,
they're looking okay. Secure their spot.
Well, we already got the fight with Pabu being taken down to about 10% HP. Canyon grabbing the kill back on him. Barrels over the wall, staying safe there with a flash, but Khan on the flank is guaranteeing everybody from Pentanets being sent home with a black and white monitor. Look at that, four for nothing for Dom1 Kia.
Nicely done, Dom1. They're going to get the ace as well. It will be delayed.
It's going to take a while. He's going to have to chase after him. Oh, these stupid blast cones.
It's kind of cruel almost. You know, Canyon just doesn't even care about ending the game. Like, he's just farming out the raptors. He's going for more counter jungling. He's going to go grab the dragon. He has the Herald. He could have just dropped it. Maybe end the suffering.
We got to pad those stats, man. They got to make it so in their next games we can bring up these crazy numbers about how I'm actually... if anybody on the Observer's Spectator team can answer this for me, does Barrel have more money than Pabu at this point? Because with all the turrets, with all the plates and everything, I'm pretty sure Barrel has more money than Pabu. 4259 versus 4529. Yeah, Pabu is about 300 gold behind Barrel. That is the current state of the game here for Pentanet.gg as the world is just melting around them. Any sort of chance to compete against Dom1 has almost completely evaporated at this point with a 14,000 lead, 17 minutes into the game. They are so close to 1K per minute, Isaac.
Yeah. I mean, Khan is more than doubling Pabu's gold. It's like, let me just gank this Jace here that's two of me.
He's actually worth it. He has Eclipse, he has the Dirk, he has completed Boots, he has his Muramana about to evolve into the Monomune. Pabu's got shoes, a Lego set, a stick, and a ring with no stacks on it. This is... it's just not comparable.
Oh, that Shock Blast, and that was through a Scrap Shield.
This... okay. All right, we got Dom1 sieging up outside the inhibitor turret of the bottom lane. Still 1.5 minutes before Baron is even allowed to spawn. Nobody's able to answer this from Pentanet. They're just trying to stick around. Biopanther goes in for the big Mega Gnar, but it won't matter too much just yet. Pentanet, they're on the board, baby. Chaz got the first one. One for one here in the bottom lane.
Nicely done. They still have the Rift Herald. Canyon will drop it, likely, I would think. Oh my God!
Oh, that was the classic Zoe experience right there. You had a health bar, then you didn't. See you later. Dom1, they're going to pick up their first inhibitor turret here
for the end
lane now. I believe they might
be
saving that Rift Herald for the end of the game right here, going after the Nexus turrets. There are three players dead on the side of Pentanet, and Dom1 are pushing towards that Nexus. Shelly will find the first Nexus turret. Second one's going to be the target now, but we will not see the Rift Herald charge yet again. The remaining turret's about to fall. Nexus now exposed. I gave you 21 minutes, Azale. They didn't even need 20. Dom1 in 19 minutes and 30 seconds looking to take down the Nexus, padding the stats a little bit more first. plus 50 gold over to Ghost and Dom Juan Kia win their game easily.
Nicely done, Dom Juan. Perhaps the most dominant game here we have seen thus far in the tournament. Incredible display from them. Great early gameplay, great execution, winning their lanes across the board. You know, Pentanet looking for those fights, not afraid to go for them, knowing that really getting some miracle kills would be their only option. But Dom Juan, too strong, too clean, really well played game from them. And they are climbing their way back towards the top of the table here. Remember, you want to be getting the best matchup that you possibly can for the knockout stage. So getting every single win here is important for Dom Juan, especially when MAD have had a good start, when RNG are looking really, really dominant, and Dom Juan have had some shaky performances. So, you know, you can expect them to really be bringing their A game here and trying to pick up every single win to get them that much-needed advantage going into the knockout stage.
And you mentioned shaky performances, but I have to make the opposite argument of the same thing I said earlier about Cloud9 when I said that they had some tragic losses, but they're still losses. Mm-hmm. Win by an inch, win by a mile. Doesn't matter, you still won. And Dom Juan are currently 3-1 in the standings. The only team that they have lost to here in the Rumble stage is RNG. They're feeling pretty good about these first couple of days of Rumble stage play.
Absolutely. You know, really, you're just looking at that one RNG loss. You're looking at the Cloud9 loss in group stage. But we got the new Axe Effect replay here. That Paddle Star does not feel good.
No.
Abu losing pretty much all his health. Easy finish there for Ghost, getting it on top of him, bursting him down. These poke champs really just aren't even poke champs when you're that far ahead. It just becomes an assassin from across the screen. This is a shock blast that is basically like a full Zed combo at that point from two screens away. So pretty frightening stuff there from Dom Juan, using that gold to the most effect that they could.
And in our next matchup, our last matchup of the day, we're going to see the Mad Lions return to the stage along with PSG Talents. Let's go ahead and check out their comms versus Cloud9 in the Sounds of the Game presented by Bose.
Do we win?
They don't have book comms.
I'm coming. I think we can.
Do we win, Marek?
I mean, I can come, but I don't know if we win.
I think we win 3 versus 3, no?
Yeah, we can.
If we kill Kindred...
I mean, Kindred is quite low, actually.
Okay, this is good. This is good for you.
I'm going.
I can now flash on them, okay? Let's just reset, though.
Yeah.
Rumble. I got him.
Oh!
Oh my god.
I can get him, okay? I can flash on Kindred. I'm gonna do it.
I'm going for Rumble.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, boys.
No flash.
Oh. What?
Oh my god.
Yeah,
oh, they're triple kill. Oh my...
What's going on, guys? I don't know what's going on.
Okay, calm down. What are we doing now, boys?
Here's the deal, Maya. State Farm offers everyone surprisingly great rates.
Right.
No, really, there are no markdowns, just great rates.
Pull around back in 20 minutes. I'll hook you up with the good parts.
When you want the real deal, like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Jake from State Farm, it's the least I can do. You really did me a solid with that, Maya markdown on my insurance.
Here's the deal, Maya. State Farm offers everyone surprisingly great rates.
Right.
No, really, there are no markdowns, just great rates.
Pull around back in 20 minutes. I'll hook you up with the good parts.
When you want the real deal, like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
on to the State Farm Analyst Desk. Our next matchup is the battle for a top three spot at the end of the day as Mad Lions and PSG Talent face off in a rematch from the group stage. Armut, he got a quadra kill earlier versus RNG, but it wasn't enough, but clearly still in good
Give me back
spirit.
My mouse pad!
Yeah, how dare you? If we get a delay to getting to stage because of those shenanigans, then we'll have a word with you. So.
Tisk, tisk.
No. So, this is, of course, a matchup we have seen before. Mad Lions got the upper hand over PSG Talent when they rumbled in the group stage. Sorry, that might confuse people because now they're in the rumble. But
and also Champions Rumble. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a little all over the place.
It's all confusing. Emily, and we heard in the interview from Hanabi saying, well, hey, at least we've played versus them, so now we can have different strategies and we can maybe find opportunities. So, where do the opportunities lie here for PSG, and how do you think Mad Lions will do?
Well, I hope PSG go in a different direction than their draft, their most recent draft, because I do think that they play best when they have lane priority, when they have the ability to kind of just lean and accrue advantages that way early on. Mad, I think, do have a lot of opportunity areas in the mid game, but I also think this against PSG, when PSG seemed to be stuck in terms of what they wanted to do, Mad were really, really quick to make a play and kind of force PSG to meet them at that play, right? So I think we saw an improvement from some of Mad's, trying to either cross map or trying to trade something on the map in the RNG series. I just think RNG ended up playing that out better, even with Mad's draft advantages, in my personal opinion. So if Mad bring that same kind of measured play to this game, I think they should be able to beat PSG.
Yeah, and I think when it comes to like getting advantages in the lane and like pushing lanes and this is something that Mad Lions were able to do against PSG the two times they faced off against them. Humanoid, of course, a big focal point. Armut was a little bit off and on when they played up in the top side, so I think making sure he's on a very strong laning pick can be important for the Mad Lions as well, because I think there is a big difference in Armut's play when he's on something he feels very comfortable in, when he sees the matchup he's going into, and then other times when he rolls up in a matchup that maybe he doesn't want to play against.
Yeah, fair. For PSG Talon, though, of course, just two games ago, they took down Cloud9. And with that, they take a huge step forward, because then all of a sudden, you're in the conversation for getting that fourth spot going into the semifinals from C9. Emily, what impressed you the most about the way they took down C9? What do they have to channel again here?
I mean, they were really able to capitalize on some of the mistakes that C9 made, right? So here, Blabber kind of sticks around to try to go for this fight, and the rest of C9 end up going into the fight as well. As we already talked about how this composition kind of is able to separate out and isolate the targets that PSG want to go for. And I think, again, this is really where both Maple and Doggo were able to pick off the damage dealers on C9.
Yes, target selection was on point and a big win for them. And in terms of Mad Lions, Ender, you've watched them now for a year and a half, and now, of course, most recently when they became champions in the spring split. And it is still very hard for me to have a read on what this team can do, because versus RNG, we saw that they actually got played off the map quite handily.
True.
Because of the macro moves. And it's very difficult for me to see where their ceiling is. But what we do know is that they are able to outplay PSG in the last couple of games.
Yeah, I do feel like Mad Lions are a team that if you give them tempo, they're gonna know how to use it and they're going to be very good at it. When you get into sort of like mid-game lulls and when it's not as like the flashy plays that you need to like, oh, we need to go for a fight around this objective or in this wave, and it's just, oh, we need to spread out, pick up the CS, these sorts of things, that's where it can be a bit of a drawback for them, and that's where I think we've seen teams like RNG surpass them. And it's not even that Mad Lions would fall behind because they're getting outfought or anything like this, but they're just dropping CS and losing in the economy game almost that you play against some of the top-notch teams.
Yeah, losing to the calculator
yeah,
rather, sometimes. Let's talk a little bit about the mid lane matchup. Maple versus Humanoid. Emily, you've said before you think that this is a matchup where in general, Maple does need to get priority from his team. Is it as much true against Humanoid and against the Mad Lions?
Oh, yeah. I mean, Mad have really, really heavily relied on Humanoid to have that mid lane pressure, right? And a lot of their early map movements have been because Humanoid has been so stifling in the mid lane. He's been able to get some of his comfort picks, like the Orianna, like the Lucian. These are things that we know he's just going to pop off on. So obviously, that is going to be a or in my opinion, it should be a focus coming out of Mad in this draft.
Yeah, and I think in my opinion, I'm like, the Lucian too is like one of those that's like automatically like free priority in the early game. And I think that that combined with any early game jungler, you're just going to win skirmishes in and around mid lane in river and any sort of jungle invades too. So while I think it can be hard to like invest bans in an Orianna and Viktor, even though Humanoid is super good at those champions, the pick like the Lucian for me is the one. If I was PSG, I wouldn't even want to mess with that. Let's get that off the board. If we can put Maple on a control mage versus control mage, I think Maple is more than good enough to hold his own in the lane. But once you get Humanoid on something that is super strong in the early game, that's where it becomes a little bit more challenging.
Yeah, we'll see what happens, but I think it'll be important for the Mad Lions not to underestimate PSG, not to think we've beat them twice and this is the same team because they've come off a huge performance versus Cloud9. We'll see who finishes the day 3-1 as we return for PSG Talon versus the Mad Lions after the break.
A lot of teams are going to stand up and recognize this team has come to play.
That away, waiting for the exhaust to come out, will now leap in, Prey is in trouble, and that's just Silas things, he's so strong. Everything is falling apart for Cloud9, that's a double for El Yoya. Maruki jungler, his first split, he makes damage, his first split, he makes